Yeah. Apparently our bell won't ring. Good morning.
Good morning.
The fourth Sunday in Lent, and I think it's a beautiful day. The day that the Lord has made, and we shall be. We shall rejoice and be glad in it. That's in Psalm 119. At this time, I would like to welcome all visitors. We are glad that you were able to come and join us, and we look forward to seeing you again. And right after the service this morning, we have refreshment in the colonial room, and we invite you to join us. Thank you. Also, there is a sign-up list in the colonial room for Palm Sunday's luncheon. So if you would like to bring a dish or so, you can sign up on this, okay? Any other announcement?
There is a bulletin. Read the announcements in the bulletin on the sheet.
Oh, yeah, okay. Let me get to the end. The announcement in the bulletin would be great to be welcome and open. There's a Bible study that meets after the service. And if you look at the announcement page, it says that on Sunday, April 28th, Nancy Jacobs will be inviting you for a brief tour of Green Brook Nature Center. Where is it? Okay. It's in the part of Palisade Nature Association, of which she's a member. So if you could come, she would appreciate it.
And the warming center? The warming center? The warming center is right about that.
In
Bulletin? Yeah.
So, the one good option.
It's almost time for us to have another rotation at the warming center. We will be serving on April 15th through 17th, 6 to 8:45 in Building D of the Xavier Center in Pomona. You can sign up in the Colonial Room or see Pam for details.
The next announcements.
Okay. There's more announcements. Now,
see where it says
session,
season of Lent, and the choir.
We start the fourth worship now. I thought we were going to do the introit.
We need to finish the announcements.
I'm sorry, I don't hear too well. Would you? Oh, I'm so sorry. That's okay. Thank you. Thank you. Excuse me for the attending a little bit. I had a challenging morning. So, season of Lent, one great hour of sharing. During Lent, as we intentionally focus on aligning our lives with God's calling for us, one great hour of sharing provides an opportunity to become, as Isaiah proclaims, repairers of the breach. For 70 years, Presbyterians have joined together in this ecumenical effort to share God's love through ministries that provide relief to those affected by disasters, food for the hungry, and support toward the self-development of poor and oppressed communities. Stay tuned to hear more.
There's another one. At the very bottom.
No. Mission meeting at the church.
Thank you.
So
Let's do the call to worship. Responsibly. Grace and peace on Jesus Christ.
Mission meeting after church today. Planning meeting for the spring cleanup. And that should conclude our announcements. Okay.
Good.
Good.
Thank you.
Would you stand please for the call for us?
Grace and peace in Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Blessed are those whose transgression is forgiven.
Thanks be to God.
Let's say the opening prayer in unison. Gracious God,
Seeker of the lost, draw your children back to your loving embrace. Restore us to our inheritance as daughters and sons, and reconcile our hearts to you, that we may become ambassadors of your reconciling love to all the world. Through Christ and by the power of the Holy Spirit, we pray. Amen.
Our opening hymn is number 271. Many and great, O God, are thy things. grace promised to us in Jesus Christ, let us confess our sins before God and one another.
Our prayer of confession this morning is entirely in silence. Amen.
Assurance of pardon, let's say responsibly. As a parent welcomes home a wayward child, so God embraces all who return in true repentance.
In the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven.
I waited patiently for the Lord. He inclined to me and heard my cry. He drew me up from the desolate pit out of the miry bog and set my feet upon a rock, making my steps secure. He put a new song in my mouth, a song of praise to our God. Many will see and fear and put their trust in the Lord. Blessed is the man who makes the Lord his trust, who does not turn to the proud, to those who go astray after false gods. Thou hast multiplied, O Lord my God, thy wondrous deeds and thy thoughts toward us. None can compare with thee. Were I to proclaim and tell of them, there would be more than can be numbered. Sacrifice and offering thou dost not desire, but thou hast given me an open ear. Burnt offering and sin offering thou hast not required. Then I said, lo, I come. In the roll of the book it is written of me. I delight to do thy will, O my God. Thy law is within my heart. I have told the glad news of deliverance in the great congregation. Lo, I have not restrained my lips, as thou knowest, O Lord. I have not hid thy saving help within my heart. I have spoken of thy faithfulness and thy salvation. I have not concealed thy steadfast love and thy faithfulness from the great congregation. Do not thou, O Lord, withhold thy mercy from me. Let thy steadfast love and thy faithfulness ever preserve me. For evils have encompassed me without number. My iniquities have overtaken me till I cannot see. Thy are more than the hairs of my head. They are more than the hairs of my head. My heart fails me. Be pleased, O Lord, to deliver me. O Lord, make haste to help me. Let them be put to shame and confusion altogether who seek to snatch away my life. Let them be turned back and brought to dishonor who desire my hurt. Let them be appalled because of their shame. who say to me, aha, aha. But may all who seek thee rejoice and be glad in thee. May those who love thy salvation say continually, great is the Lord. As for me, I am poor and needy, but the Lord takes thought for me. Thou art my help and my deliverer. Do not tarry, O my God. This is the word of God.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Christina.
The main children in the church?
Maxine.
I think only Kelly today.
I think Maxine is here.
Maxine! There you go. Hi, Maxine. Come up here. Hi, Maxine. I don't quite have my full voice back, so.
Do you need
a mic? No, I can pretend.
Okay.
Jackson, good morning. Okay, well, today's children's story is about Jesus and his lost sheep.
Okay, can everybody hear me now? Sorry, everybody, I lost my voice. So I'm doing my sick hair today. Okay, so today's story time is about Jesus and how he lost his sheep. How a shepherd lost his sheep. Have you ever lost anything? Have you ever lost anything? You couldn't find it, right? And you were looking everywhere for it. How did it feel to find it? When you finally found it, how did you feel? It feels good. And what did you want to do when you lost something? Do you want to say hooray? Yeah, right? Do you want to tell your friends, your family, that you lost that something that's special? Yeah? Okay. Well, just like the shepherd lost their sheep. When you lose something, you can always find Jesus right there waiting for you. Okay, so when we lost something, all we have to do is look for it. When we find it, we can rejoice in it with our friends and our family, right? Like the shepherd did when he found his sheep. Let us pray. Thank you, Lord, for bringing us together so that we can share in the love and finding the things that we cannot find alone. Thank you, Lord, for our friends and our family that we get to rejoice and share the things that we find, like the love that you have shown us in your love of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
Amen. Gospel lesson is actually Luke 7:36-50. That was my error for some reason. I think I was reading it in Roman numerals. I don't always do that very well. So Luke 7:36-50. Listen to hear the word of the Lord. One of the Pharisees asked Jesus to eat with him, and he went into the Pharisee's house and took his place at the table. And a woman in the city, who was a sinner, having learned that he was eating in the Pharisee's house, brought an alabaster jar of ointment. She stood behind him at his feet, weeping, and began to bathe his feet with her tears and dry them with her hair. Then she continued kissing his feet and anointing them with the ointment. Now when the Pharisee who had invited him saw it, he said to himself, "If this man were a prophet, he would have known who and what kind of woman this is who is touching him, that she is a sinner." Jesus spoke up and said to him, "Simon, I have something to say to you." "Teacher," he replied, "speak." A certain creditor had two debtors. One owed him 500 denarii and the other 50. When they could not pay, he canceled the debts for both of them. "Now which of them will love him more?" Simon answered, "I suppose the one for whom he had canceled the greater debt." And Jesus said to him, "You have judged rightly." Then turning toward the woman, he said to Simon, "Do you see this woman? I entered your house and you gave me no water for my feet, but she has bathed my feet with her tears and dried them with her hair. You gave me no kiss, but from the time she came in, I came in, she has not stopped kissing my feet. You did not anoint my head with oil, but she has anointed my feet with ointment. Therefore I tell you, her sins, which were many, have been forgiven. Hence she has shown great love. But the one to whom little is forgiven loves little. Then he said to her, your sins are forgiven. But those who were at the table with him began to say among themselves, who is this who even forgives sins? And he said to the woman, your faith has saved you. Go in peace. This is the word of the Lord. So today, as we take a look through all of the different understandings of how God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself, we move into the 12th century. Europe had calmed down a little bit, and the so-called Dark Ages weren't quite so dark. The schools attached to cathedrals had replaced the monasteries as seats of learning. Soon after Anselm, who had articulated a satisfaction theory of atonement, meaning Jesus died to restore or satisfy honor due to God that sin had ended, a young scholar named Peter Abelard thought there was a better way to explain how God was in Christ, reconciling the world to God. Now, Peter Abelard is better known for his love affair with Eloise and subsequent castration by her father's family in the belief that his relationship with Eloise impugned the family honor. Perhaps it's no wonder that he disagreed with an atonement theory based on honor. For Abelard, Jesus is our moral example. He believed that Jesus is God incarnate, but the incarnation played a lesser role than it did for Irenaeus in Recapitulation or Anselm in Satisfaction. In Abelard's words, the purpose and cause of the incarnation was that Christ might illumine the world by his wisdom and excite it to love of himself. For Abelard, the central aspect of atonement was God's love. Greg Allison says, people needed their love for God stimulated by a convincing exhibition of love on the part of Christ. He provided such a demonstration by his life and death, which was the crowning act of love. In other words, when our love is awakened by Christ's death, it helps save us. The resurrected Christ's intercessory prayers complete that merit, according to Abelard. As Bonnie Christian says, Abelard said when our sin made a loving relationship between God and humans impossible, God became human to demonstrate the depth of his love by his suffering and death. As we observe the love of Christ on the cross, we're motivated to reconcile with God and model our lives after Jesus. Because of Christ's example, Abelard wrote, we cling both to him and to our neighbor by the indestructible bond of love. Now, it probably won't surprise you to learn that this understanding of atonement never really gained a lot of traction in Christian theology. Let's start with what it fails to take into account. It does not take seriously, indeed Abelard hardly mentions, Christ's suffering and torturous death on the cross. It does not take sin very seriously as a condition into which we are all born. Abelard said, sin consists in agreeing to the evil inclination of the mind. In other words, we sin as a matter of the misuse of our own free will. But Scripture is clear that sin is cosmic. Listen to Paul in a letter to the Ephesians. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. If you don't believe that, read a newspaper sometimes, or listen to a news podcast. heart's understanding of atonement says nothing about God's justice. There are, however, good points to a moral understanding of atonement. It focuses on the life and teaching of Jesus in a way that the other two understandings, recapitulation and satisfaction, do not. In those understandings, it's as though Jesus could have been born and done nothing for 33 years and then just died and been resurrected, and that would have been good enough. Abelard understands that God's love is to be highlighted, not God's retribution and wrath. His understanding draws heavily on the ethical teaching of Jesus. Read the Gospels. They're full of how we are supposed to behave as children of God. It is scriptural, as both of our texts this morning indicate. Sacrifice and offering you do not desire, says the psalmist, but you have given me an open ear. Burnt offering and sin offering you have not required. And in Luke 7:47, therefore I tell you, her sins, which were many, have been forgiven. Hence she has shown great love. But the one to whom little is forgiven loves little. Indeed, this verse was kind of what started Anselm down the road to this theory in the first place. We occasionally reference this theory in hymns. For he is our childhood's pattern, day by day like us he grew. He was weak, he was little, weak and helpless, tears and smiles like us he knew. And our eyes at last shall see him through his own redeeming love. For that child so dear and gentle is our Lord in heaven above. And he leads his children on to the place where he has gone. Yes, that's a Christmas hymn. And yes, we're going to sing it as our closing hymn today. So then, how do we come to the table of our Lord if we want to think in terms of this understanding of atonement? Better than last week. Saints, this table has moral and ethical implications. We cannot eat at this table and take seriously the sacrificial love of Christ for us and not be changed. We cannot sit in the heavenly places where Christ is host and eat with him and not go out to live as he taught us and showed us by his example, not if we are going to claim the name Christian. Jesus spent a lot of his ministry on earth in ethical teaching. It's all through the gospel, and sometimes it's in scary ways. Matthew 25 tells us that those who feed the hungry, clothe the naked, give drink to the thirsty, are welcomed into his Father's house. Those who do not are cast into the outer darkness. Abelard reminds us that atonement requires response. Free from sin, we are free for joyful, loving service. And we are given the Holy Spirit to empower us for that service. May it be so. And let the people of God say. Let us stand now and say what we believe using the ecumenical version of the Nicene Creed. It is found on page 15 of your hymnal. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate.
suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated on the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
The peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
one great hour of sharing. I have experienced in my life of the love of Christ that I have received and I will never forget the rest of my life. Again, when Robin passed away, I got a lot of love, care, and sharing from my church family, New Hampshire Presbyterian Church, and all my friends, Indonesian friends, the Christian and Muslim. They bring to my home food, flowers, car, with the money. I'm telling you, money. And we all need money. And that's really helped me a lot. The deacon helped me with the lunch that day. And Karen put together all the picture. So I really feel the love, care, sharing for my family church. And I will do the same thing. If somebody needs it, I will help with the money. And we know we all need money. As a Christian, we're helping each other. We have a mission to show and practice the love of God that Jesus teaching us to spread the good news. So one great hour sharing, we will pray for the amount of money that we will share and we will give it. Like in Ephesians 4, chapter 7, to tell that each of us was given grace according to the measure of Christ's gift. Our denomination combines my gift and your gift to help on grand scale. One great sharing hours, money go to help for disaster assistance, the hunger program, the financial assistance and self-development of people. And the next week, you will hear more and more about our riches. One great hour. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.
As people of the new creation, let us offer ourselves and our gifts to God.
Thank you.
shelter. O God, we have beheld your goodness to us. Accept the offering of the work of our hands, and use us for the sake of Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Sisters and brothers, this table before us is Christ's table, and I, ministering in his name, invite all who seek to love and to serve him to come now to this feast of the kingdom of God. We will receive again today by intinction. Sylvia and I will be holding bread and cup. You come forward, receive the elements, and return to your seats. Join with me in the great prayer of thanksgiving. May Abba, our God, be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts to the one who welcomes us home.
We open them to our God, who runs to embrace us with grace.
Sing glad songs to the one who provides this feast.
We join in singing to God, who throws a party for us in his place.
On those days you called creation from the hiding places of your imagination. Mighty rivers rushed down to the seas. A rainbow of produce sprang up in fields. Day and night rippled with your beauty. All this was from you, God of wonder, gifts for those created in your image. But we demanded our share, traveling to that far country called death, squandering everything in sin's hidden shadows. Longing for us to come home, you sent the prophets to surround us with glad songs of deliverance, but we regarded their words as empty husks, continuing to waste away all our days. So you sent Jesus, your Son, to lead us back from the dead, so we might celebrate your life. With all the prodigals as well as the pious, with all the saints as well as the sinners, with all the faithful, we sing to you.
Holy, 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 God, who reconciles us to yourself, all creation is glad and rejoices. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who finds the lost and has them home. Hosanna in the highest.
Holy are you, God of prodigals, and blessed is Jesus Christ, in whom there is no deceit. Coming into that far country we call life, he shared the gifts of grace and peace. Telling us stories of families reunited, he points us to you sitting by the kingdom's window. Seeing us green-eyed with jealousy, he hands us the glasses of reconciliation so that we might see others in a new way. Going to the cross,